introductory part of the plan, which is the first opening part of it, the introduction, it's called a prologue. The objective is for you guys to get familiar with a little bit, the style that Shakespeare wrote in. Remember, that style is 400 years old. The play was written nearly 400 years ago. So it's a little bit of a different kind of language than you're used to. So I want to show you also what the sonnet form is like, what a sonnet is. You may have heard that word before, a sonnet. And I'm sure you probably don't know enough about poetry to know what a sonnet is. We'll take a look at a sonnet and see what I call a sonnet. Okay? In addition to that, we'd like to see the characteristics of the sonnet and the style that it was written in and a little bit about the language that was used in those days when Shakespeare wrote the play, Romeo and Juliet. And we can do most of this just by understanding the opening introduction, the prologue of the play. The first thing I need to do is to get out a little piece of notebook paper. It doesn't have to be, oh wait, on second thought, you can use the back side of the little worksheet and then we'll have to use a separate sheet of paper. Let me pass this out to you. Three sentences that answer these questions. First of all, question number one, all of you answer this. What is a feud? What is a feud? In your own mind, don't do it right now, wait till I give you all three questions. What do you think a feud is? Try and write a sentence that tells me that answer. It answers that question. Okay, secondly, I want you to tell about one feud that you know of that's going on right now or it's gone on sometime in your life. Who was fighting against whom? Okay, so say something in one sense about a feud that you know about. No hints, don't tell anybody else, it's all for you to do all by yourself. And thirdly, is this. What would happen to two people if they were on opposite sides of the feud and they fell in love? What do you think would happen to those two people in your own mind? Three short sentences. People who might be involved in one. Heard the term? Not the funny answer, the real answer.
I agree.
Okay,
man.
Sorry.
A fight or disagreement.
Right, a fight or disagreement? Okay? A fight or a disagreement is a feud. That's one of the characteristics of a feud. Who's got a different definition or can add to that a little bit? What'd you put, James, for a feud?
Well, that's the same thing he says, disagreement. Anything you can add to it?
Human beings disagreeing, okay? A little bit closer. Anybody got anything else? Richard, I'm sorry, Robert, I can't hear you. Two religions fighting against each other? Excellent. Good idea. Two groups that have different opinions, right? Okay, well, we'll go on to the second question then. A feud is a disagreement or a fight between two opposing groups. They could be religious groups or they could be other kinds of groups. Let's see if you can think of a feud that's going on now that you might be aware of, that you've heard about, or from your history. Who can name a feud?
All right, Desert Storm.
Desert Storm? Okay, you can say that's a feud. That's a war, right? One group of people against another group of people. What's another one?
Princess Di and Prince.
There you go, good one. Princess Di and Prince Charles who are arguing, feuding. That's not exactly a feud, it's not two different groups of people, it's just an argument between two people. What's another one, Ariana?
The
Wyatt.
The Wyatt. The
Wyatt. Aha. Who is feuding in the LA riots?
People against
the... No, Ariana. For the two sides fighting each other. A lot of people think that one example is the black people that are in the inner city against the whites who have all the money. Well, that's definitely two groups against each other. And you said another one possibility.
The cops
versus the blacks, right? And they don't care if the cops are black or white. Anybody who works for the Los Angeles Police Department is against certain groups of blacks in the city. All right. What's the name of two gangs you can think of that are feuding among themselves, shooting each other all the place?
Criminal Bloods.
The what?
Crips.
Right, there's an example of feuding. That gang in Central LA known as the Crips and the other gang known as the Bloods are
two factions that are fighting each other. That's a feud. Here in Buena Park, even, we have some feuding taking place between various gangs. You know, Los Coyotes is one gang. I don't know if they're feuding necessarily, but different gangs are fighting each other. Okay, what do you suppose would happen? Think about it before you answer. What do you suppose would happen if you were a member of, say, the Crips, and you met a girl, or the opposite sex, that was a member of the Bloods, and you happened to fall in love, and you knew that each of you was a member of the opposite feuding group? What do you suppose would happen? Romeo and Juliet is about. Most people know the story of Romeo and Juliet already. It's going to have to be told. And it's not a surprise. It's such a popular story that you probably know that Romeo is from one family. He falls in love with Juliet, but she's from another family. And their two families are fighting. They're having a feud. So let's see if what happens, what Danny said happens. They both get killed or something like that. All right. Now, next thing we're going to do is we're going to look at the opening of the play, which is on the back side. You can turn that sheet over. See where it says prologue at the top. This is the introduction that Shakespeare wrote to the play. Okay? Count how many lines there are, real quickly, and write the number down off the side. The total number of lines. How many lines are there? 14, right? Anybody get a different number? 37. No, don't count the questions at the bottom, just the lines in the prologue. Yeah, 14 lines. That's important. You're going to find out. Remember I told you that one of the things we're going to do today is familiarize you with a particular type of poetry called a sonnet. That's the first characteristic. All sonnets have exactly 14 lines. Okay, now we're going to do this. I'm going to put you into groups. There'll be four groups. One group will have four lines. And what you have to do with those four lines is read it over and quickly write in one sentence what you think that means in modern, regular English that you normally use. It'll be difficult because some of the words you don't know, they're old. So I'll walk around and help you with that. So here are the groups. We need just four groups, so I'll take these four people, Danny, Scott, Sybil, and you're one group. You move your chairs a moment, don't do it now. You'll be a second group, just three people in that group. And then you four, right here, Richard, John, Ernie, Ben, you're group number three because you're close to each other, and then this group of three. Just move your desk around a moment. You understand what you have to do? You can write it on the back side of this piece of paper. This group takes the first four lines of that prologue. You read them amongst yourselves, figure out what it's saying in regular English, and one person write it down. I don't care who. Then, choose one person to say it out loud to me when I ask for the information. What do you think those four lines mean in regular English? Got it? You do the same thing with the next four lines. Only read those four. You can read your first four if you want to figure out what's going on, but don't report on those. One of you writes it down, all of you decide. And one of you is ready to report it. Okay, you guys will take the next four lines. You can read the first eight lines if you want to figure out what's going on, but you only tell me in one sentence what happens, what's going on, what that prologue is trying to say in those four lines. Got it? Now, there are only two lines left. You left out. But unfortunately, those two lines are the hardest to figure out. So don't worry, I'll be around to help you. Understand what you're supposed to do. Okay, one other thing everybody has to do. Count the number of syllables in each line that's in your little section. For instance, section one, all four lines have the same number of syllables in each line. You count that, tell me what that number is. You guys, in your four lines, each line has the same number of syllables. Count how many. Got it? Okay, ready to go.
Move your desk around.
Any words you don't understand, just, you know, raise your hand, I'm going to tell you what they are, because they're pretty old words, some of them. First of all, count the number of syllables.
How many did you get? That's number 35 syllables.
No, just be quiet.
1998.
Yes, that's so, not words, it's syllables.
9.
2. How many syllables are you counting? Turn around, face me. Hey, don't have much time, guys. 5 minutes, you gotta take time. Turn your little spirit around with that. That's the exact same dose of that. Yeah, that's good. We'll do that later. Ten syllables in every one of the lines. That's important. So we know one of the qualities of the sonnet is that it has 14 lines all together. Now we're finding out that at least some of them have 10 syllables. So far, so good. I said there's 3 main characteristics. Alright, what is your 4 lines? First I'll read it in Shakespeare writing, and then you tell me what you think it means in modern English. Two households, both alike in dignity, in fair Verona, where we lay our scene, from ancient grudge breaks to new mutiny. Where civil hands, civil blood rather, makes civil hands unclean. What do you think that meant, right?
Two families fighting into each other's blood and Verona.
Exactly. Two families are fighting themselves in this play, and they're shedding each other's blood in the city of Verona. Anybody know what country Verona was in?
In Spain.
Doesn't say here. That's a good guess. Sounds like a Spanish word, but it's not.
Greece.
Italy? Italy?
No, no. Yeah, right.
Did you say Italy?
It's right.
Oh, it is?
Okay. Yeah, it's Italy. All right. Okay. Pretty good idea now, just what are the characteristics of a Shakespearean sonnet. You're not going to have to write one yourself, so you don't have to worry about that. First of all, how many lines did we come up with? 14, correct? That's the first characteristic. The sonnet has 14 lines. Very difficult to write a poem in just 14 lines and say something meaningful. Secondly, we have how many syllables? 10 syllables, right? Every line had exactly 10 syllables. Later, maybe we'll talk about what that's called, that form of writing, is iambic pentameter. So for now, we have the length of the poem and the number of syllables per line. The last thing is the rhyming. We talked about the rhyming. Okay, there's a pattern of rhyme all the way through the sonnet. The first line rhymes with the third line. The second line rhymes with the fourth line, etc. That whole rhyming pattern is carried throughout. Think how difficult it must have been for Shakespeare 400 years ago to write a poem of exactly 14 lines, exactly 140 syllables with that kind of a tight rhyming pattern. You can see why the people of the time may have appreciated his style. Fortunately, people don't write that way today. If they did, it would be very difficult for us to read what they write and to understand it. Consequently, when we understand that and when we read Shakespeare, we appreciate that it has to be read slowly. We have to look for the meaning because it's so tightly written. Okay? Now, I told you that we were going to put all this together. The thing I want to do now is show you the beginning of the videotape of the play by Franco Zeffirelli. It opens with the prologue, and the prologue is being spoken by a professional actor. Just listen to the first 8 lines and the beautiful music that goes with it. See if you feel, as I do, that this is a beautiful piece of writing. Okay, now, you didn't you've been given a worksheet on which you've been recording your responses. You see that there are 9 questions that have to do with this prologue. I want you to answer all 9 of those questions, each of you individually. Bring that back tomorrow. We'll start off tomorrow going over those answers to review. Any questions? None? Okay, good. Thanks for paying attention. See you tomorrow.